Beyond Resilience is a series of curated conversations created by Firelight with the purpose of exploring the challenges, strategies, and experiences of creating and distributing work during a time of crisis.
Nobody's going to give us any power until we ask for it, until we demand it.
The role of storytellers right now is to tell those stories that people are refusing to tell and to do so in a transparent manner.
It is critical to me that my team, again, reflect the community that we are going to be talking about, or the community that is the subject.
There are so many missing narratives in the Black experience that would do so much to help both the understanding of Black people in our current situation, but also other people who are trying to understand what's going on.
The decision makers need to change. It is not okay that this small group of white folks are the ones who determine which stories matter, which filmmakers matter, and decide and set the terms on which these stories are made. That is literally what has gotten us to the place that we are in.
We're talking about systemic change, you know, not a one-time grant to.
The subject of this discussion is called Crack, Cocaine, Corruption, and Conspiracy, and it's now streaming worldwide on Netflix. I hope most of you have had a chance to see it. If you have not, please do check it out. In addition to our production work, Firelight Media supports a program called the Documentary Lab, which is an 18-month fellowship supporting first or time or second time BIPOC filmmakers, and Groundwork Regional Labs, which supports very early stage filmmakers in the American South, Midwest, and the US territories. We're very proud to present this series, Beyond Resilience, which is something that we hatched at the start of the pandemic. We're very grateful to Open Society Foundations for its sponsorship of the series. For more information and additional resources around today's conversations, as well as records of past Beyond Resilience events, please visit us at firelightmedia.tv/beyondresilience. Now I want to introduce Moikgantse Ngama and thank her and Image Nation for their partnership on this event. Many of you, I'm sure, know Moikgantse as a stalwart supporter of Black film and stalwart of the artistic community in Harlem. So we're very grateful for her and Image Nation's partnership on the event. Moikgantse is herself, in addition to being founder and executive director of Image Nation, she is an audience development specialist and a filmmaker. Her credits include I Will Follow, the Academy Award nominated Trouble the Water, Killer Sheep, and Lumumba, two of my favorites, to name a few. Moikgantse's accolades also include being named one of 25 women who are shaping the world by Essence Magazine, and she received the Trailblazer Award from Real Sisters Film Festival, which I didn't know, I got that award too, as well as a proclamation from the City of New York for her work with Image Nation. Moikgantse?
Hello, how are you? And thank you so much for inviting us to be a part of this program today. For those of you who don't know Image Nation, Marcia gave such a wonderful introduction. I don't think there's anything more to say, but I'll say that I run the organization with my partner and husband, Gregory Gates. Of course, we are a Harlem-based media arts organization dedicated to depicting the global Black experience. We do that by presenting a variety of public programs that foster media equity, media literacy, solidarity, cross-cultural exchange, and highlight the humanity of Pan-African people worldwide. We're in the process of developing our Soul Cinema Cafe, which has been slightly delayed by COVID, but it's still coming. And we've also pivoted to develop a streaming platform that is coming very soon, so stay tuned. You can learn more about us at imagenation.us, as in United States, as in us Black folks. And you can also visit us at soulcinemacafe.com. We always have film streaming and available VOD at soulcinemacafe.com. And that's S-O-L, no U. So we're really, really proud to be part of this program. Again, thank you so much, Marcia and Stanley, and just the whole Firelight family for inviting us to participate. I think that the film itself illuminates the importance of us controlling our narrative, and this conversation will further illuminate what happens and what it means to have access within your community to the institutions that represent you, to the institutions like the media, like law enforcement, like the medical community. And you know, the importance of agency and representation within those institutions. And I'm sure we'll also discuss, you know, what it looks like when we don't have that control, when you're faced with pandemics like crack, like HIV, and now COVID-19. And so, you know, have a wonderful talk. We're very happy to be helping to facilitate, and hopefully we put some, not butts in seats, but likes on the screen, and have a great afternoon.
Thank you, Moikgantse, and thank you for your partnership over the years. And we look forward to when we can actually physically get back in your space. And
me too.
I want to see the bricks and the seats, and I know as I know you're going to grow. So thank you for your partnership. And now to kick us off, I am thrilled to introduce our moderator for today, who's my dear friend Asha Bandele. Asha Bandele is an award-winning journalist and New York Times bestselling and multiple award-winning author of 6 books, including The Prisoner's Wife, Daughter, and When They Call You a Terrorist, a Black Lives Matter memoir. And she is most proudly the mother of an extraordinary daughter, Nisa. Asha is a lifelong social justice advocate who built a model grants and partnership program that supported ending America's drug war. Asha is a prison abolitionist, and Asha currently serves as the director of strategic initiatives for Galaxy Gives, the philanthropic vehicle for the Novogratz family. But if you know anything about Asha, you know she's always doing many other things in addition. For many years, she was a member of the senior editorial team at Essence Magazine, as well as on the production team for its internationally renowned music festival. She lives and works in Brooklyn, my hometown, where she is completing 2 works of nonfiction for Random House, One World, and for the New Press. And thank you, Asha, for agreeing to be pressed into service as our moderator today. And I turn it over to you.
Thank you so much, Marcia and Moikgantse, for all of your work over the years. I don't know that I could have imagined that there would be a time that I would be introduced by you, Marcia, who has been such a guide, a northern light, truly, for me, for many years and in many ways. But I'll also recognize, as the producers wisely reminded us, to say that while I sit here from the People's Republic of Brooklyn, this is also land that was once lived upon by the Lenape people. And so it's good to have that reminder about who is here and who's not as we begin this discussion with the election of Ronald Reagan in 1980, which ushered in this extraordinary period of harm for Black communities across America, undermining the gains of the civil rights and Black power eras that had ended a decade before. This is a man who announced his candidacy standing in the blood-soaked soil of Philadelphia, Mississippi, who would refer to African leaders as monkeys who didn't even know how to wear shoes, who would give our children ketchup and call it a vegetable, even as he cut the budgets for urban schools. I just want to do some scene setting here. He ensured that many of us were struggling with the sort of existing twin pandemics of white supremacy and poverty would not survive with his cutting out of the social safety net, because it's into this climate, and it's important to context set as the film does, that crack is introduced. It's a cheaper smokable version of powder cocaine, although the two drugs are pharmaceutically the exact same thing. But it's the treatment of those who are perceived to use crack that's so wildly different from the treatment of those who are perceived to use powder cocaine. Prison sentences for possession of crack run at 100 times the rate of prison sentences for those who are in possession of powder cocaine. And although, which people forget, most of the drug is used and sold in white communities, it's Black people at 80% who are arrested, who are targeted for arrest and incarcerated. And this is what this incredible new film, Crack, Corruption and Conspiracy, directed by the legendary Stanley Nelson, and as Marcia said, which is now streaming worldwide. It's a huge moment on Netflix. You've made me cool in front of my daughter, almost. is discussing and how the exponential presence of cocaine even in America in the 1980s is born of decisions the Reagan administration illegally makes itself. And so with that said, I wanna just take a moment and ask if we can just turn and see this trailer together. Felecia, would you help me?
In the 80s, there was a lifestyle of celebration and coke was part of that lifestyle.
It was the glitzy drug.
When crack came along, it changed everything about the Black community and it changed everything about America.
It was like the gold rush. It was people coming from all over to buy this wonder drug.
The drug so powerful, it will make you sell the clothes off your back.
The reporting played right into all of these stereotypes and this narrative.
But it's like that, and that's the way it is.
We must be intolerant of drug use and drug sellers.
You got a war on drugs. Is it not a war on the people that are supplying the drugs? Or is it only a war on the victims of the drug war?
Just say no.
It felt extraordinarily hypocritical. This was happening at a time when the US government was turning a blind eye to cocaine smuggling.
Our goal was to defeat communism in Central America. And if that meant drugs got in and the youth of America used them, well, that was the way it was going to be.
We knew that they were in on it. We knew that they were dealing on the side.
What would you steal?
Money and drugs and guns, whatever was there.
That was kind of like chemical warfare on Black communities.
Don't take my mother, please.
It's a story that has to be told.
Why am I making my life so hard? What is wrong with me?
That was particularly hard scene, Don't Take My Mother. And you know, it's interesting to hear all this music again with new ears as somebody who was growing up in the 1980s, but it's really my honor to facilitate a conversation with three of the people who were in the film, and of course with you, Stanley Nelson, our beloved, our visual griot. And I'm going to introduce each of you and just ask if you would, to give some context, a brief description of your surroundings and yourself, so, and any kind of key identifier, just briefly, so that we ensure the greatest possible accessibility for our audience. And I'll begin with you, Felecia Pullen, a licensed social worker, a doctoral candidate at Fordham University, my father's alma mater. You're in recovery. You specialize in policy development around substance use disorders, and you started Let's Talk Safety, which is a youth-focused substance misuse program located in Harlem. And I just want to welcome you, Felecia.
Thank you, Asha. I'm honored to be here and to be among so many really esteemed people. So I feel like this really small grain of sand among this very large conversation. And thank you for having me here.
It's just my pleasure. And just and I'll keep it here in the great Black Mecca of Harlem with you, Dr. Punter, the president and CEO of Harlem Congregations for Community Improvement, providing just, and I remember when all of this work was first happening, so it's really extraordinary, providing not only the social services programs that people need, but ensuring affordable housing in the community. Thank you for all of your years of dedicated work and service on behalf of our people, and welcome.
Thank you, Asha Mandali, and I'm happy to be here. Harlem Congregations for Community Improvement, as you know, has been working in the community and has taken on the responsibility of revitalizing the Harlem community. And having grown up in this community, going and went to school here, walking to school every day, you know, this footage, you know, really brings back the visceral memories that I have of living in Harlem. And, you know, my wife and I, we raise our children in Harlem. We still live here. We raise our children here. And I am very happy that my son and daughter does not have to grow up in the Harlem that I did. And, you know, certainly we'll expand on that as we go along. But thank you. I'm glad to be here with you all.
Thank you so much. And Samson Styles, who I feel like I already know, and this way that you just navigate us through so much of the story. I almost didn't have to read in your bio that you'd been a BET correspondent, because it's, you know, you were so natural at it. And now, and I make sure that I say it like this, running it with your wife, you're the founder and the lead on a digital and linear content production company, JC Enterprise. And you know, importantly, to me and to so many people, you're passing it on, teaching young people to be documentary filmmakers. Welcome, Samson.
Thank you for having me. I want to thank Firelight and Image Nation for putting this together and inviting me here. And like you said, it's all about giving back and using my testimony as a healing process and a building process, you know, and I'm just happy to be here.
Thank you. And, you know, it's always humbling, incredible, humbling honor. And I thank you for including me regularly, Marcia Smith's husband, otherwise known as the great Stanley Nelson. It's kind of hard to like run down. When you know someone, you kind of forget everything that's there. But we're talking to the MacArthur Genius Award winner. We're talking to, I mean, multiple Emmys, multiple Peabody's, a lifetime Emmy Award achievement. And then, you know, in 2013, and it's important, I think, sometimes to say the year so we know what president we're talking about, the National Medal in the Humanities from Barack Obama for your dedication and artistry in illuminating an American history, American histories rarely told. And so on behalf of a grateful nation, my honor to sit before you and thank you for your willingness to share our truths. And I'd like to start, you know, by talking with you, Stanley, but let me give you a moment to say a couple of words before I launch in with questions.
Yeah, great. Thank you. I'm not on mute, am I? Good. Thank you so much. You know, it's great to be here among everybody. You know, if it hasn't been said, you know, Firelight is a Harlem-based film production company and media company, and we're Harlem-based. And I was born and raised in Harlem. And, still have the pleasure of living in Harlem. And so, you know, I'm Harlem through and through. One thing, you know, I was just thinking about, I never said this before, you know, as Felecia was talking and Samson was talking, and I thought about Susan Burton, you know, and people who have recovered and, you know, are doing such great things. And all the lives that were lost and all the brain power that was lost and all the goodness that was lost, you know, to crack, you know, that, you know, we didn't seek these people out because they had recovered. We sought them out for their stories, but, you know, part of their stories were that they recovered and that they're, you know, leading really productive lives, but, you know, that isn't everybody, you know, and lives were lost and, you know, so much goodness was lost to this pandemic of crack that could have been prevented.
You know, thank you for that grounding. I think often people get so attached to slogans and what have you, we forget what we're actually here about. And we are doing this work standing in blood. We are doing this work standing an incredible loss. And it's the importance of your work, Stanley. What I was saying to you earlier, I think of you and I think of the late great Toni Morrison talking about maintaining a Black gaze and the importance of it. Stories that we tell for us, about us, that are not concerned about bowing before other people. And I think it's, you know, you got to ground it in that, right? What did the media get wrong? What was this course correction designed to do in this film?
Well, I mean, the media got everything wrong about crack and the crack epidemic. You know, first it was ignored, you know, and pretended like it wasn't happening for anybody that lived in Harlem or any, you know, major city or even small city. You know, the crack was being dealt right out on the street. You know, you didn't have to be a detective to find it. You know, it was everywhere. It was everywhere. And the police, law enforcement, just let it go. You know, as Samson, one of my favorite lines in the film, he says it was like a gold rush to the hood, you know, because all of a sudden, you know, young people could make money because they weren't scared of being arrested or being stopped at first, you know. And then once the media and politicians and law enforcement caught on, then it was these crazy sentences, as you talked about, you know, 100 to 1. So 5 grams of crack would get you the same as 500 grams of cocaine, you know. And if people don't know 5 grams, 5 grams is like a sugar packet. No, I mean, sorry, 1 gram is like a sugar packet. So, you know, you could have 5 packets of sugar in your back pocket. You weren't a dealer, but you were now under mandatory sentencing that would send you to jail for incredible periods of time. So that, you know, everything, they got everything wrong. We go into in the film, especially the way it devastated African-American women, you know, and that the myth of the crack hoe, you know, or your mama's on crack rock and all those things were perpetuated by the media or the media just took it and ran with it without any evidence of anything. So it was, you know, for those who don't remember, who are too young to remember, it's called the crack era because it was a real era. It was something that took over the Black and Latinx communities. And we're still dealing with the fallout. You know, people are still incarcerated. The communities are devastated.
Thank you, you know, for that. And, you know, a lot of times, and I'm going to turn to you, Dr. Punter, after this, but, you know, I think a lot about this as being also the Reagan era, right? And because one of the points that is brought out in the film is really about not as much what is put into the community as what is taken out. Because you know, as much cocaine and crack is done on Wall Street, as it's done uptown, right? But why doesn't Wall Street fall apart? I found something in the New York Times that was reported in 1987 where it talked about white people fearing Black poverty because they were starting to see Black militancy at its highest rate since the 1960s and 70s. And so, you know, that made me think about, wow, you know, look at all the people they threw away in disruption of that. And I wonder, Dr. Punter, I'm not saying your last name right. I don't know what's wrong with me. Punter, right? Punter, like that?
Punter.
See, I don't know what's wrong with me today. But I wonder that to the extent that a lot of us bought into media portrayals of us and, you know, contributed to the stigmatization of us, and that continues to today as well, do you think we were, in Malcolm's words, bamboozled? Do we bear any responsibility? And those trucks that came and 2.2 million people went missing.
You know, I think Stanley and his team have done a wonderful job in this documentary. I watched it twice. I watched it initially for the sort of the novelty of it, and then I watched it as a researcher and academic. But you know, because I was born and raised, as I said before, in Harlem, third generation Harlemite. I not only lived through that particular era as a teenager, I also had the historical memory of my parents and grandparents and the contrast of what Harlem was like prior to the epidemic, right? So, you know, they remember the renaissance of the Harlem community. They remember the activism of Malcolm and the communities at large. And they remember the pride. But this particular, in my opinion, this particular epidemic was intentional because of the activism and the strength of the Black community and the vocalness and criticism of the civil rights movement. They had it to create a situation to diminish the strength of that movement. I believe that the strength, I believe that particular strategy was intentional, and it was made to do that. And the documentary kind of says, yes, that's true, right? Because President Reagan and his cohorts were directly responsible for the triangle of evil, right? That thing that, gave missiles and munitions to Iran, and then, supply the Contras in Central America, and then they supplying cocaine and high amounts and quantities into the inner cities. And when you already had a community that were underserved, right? I remember the thick line of demarcation in Manhattan. Across 110th Street, right?
Hometown.
People on 110th Street, and they were below 110th Street. Mm-hmm. Right? But somehow, the heavy drugs and the violence that came with it happened to be on across 110th Street. Everybody else was relatively safe from that. So that's an intentional strategy. And in 1990, there were over 2,500 murders in the city of New York. All of that violence was contributed to the drugs that were placed in our community. So the drugs are intentionally placed, and the violence that comes with it, which gave, you know, certain people a justification for being heavy-handed and creating the Rockefeller drug laws and creating, the expansion of the prison industrial complex, which then fueled, you know, the economies of rural New York State towns who had an incentive to keep people coming up to those prisons.
Yeah.
Right. So it's a self-perpetuating cycle. And you know who's on the menu? It was Black and Latino children and men and women.
Right. And of course, the architecture for the modern prisons system is put in place long before the introduction of any of the Rockefeller drug laws too. You know, Nelson Rockefeller wants to run for vice president, and, you know, he does that in 1973 before anybody's talking about crack. And I just want to say again, crack is used and sold more in white communities. I just think we need to focus on that, and they don't fall apart. I don't want us to ever lose sight of that, right? That they don't fall apart. Wall Street does not fall apart. And they have as much as we do. So is it the drug or is it the policies, right? Which did more harm? And I think that that's part of what this film asks us to do as well. That's my thinking. And I'm going to ask us to just put on that next trailer before we bring Felecia and Samson into it. But thank you for that incredible history, and what a memory to be able to have people who could talk to you about the Harlem Renaissance. Thank you for that.
Of course.
I think we're going to a trailer.
I was sentenced to prison 6 different times. You would have thought someone would have said that you don't have a criminal problem. You have an alcohol or a drug problem. And there's help for that. But I was never offered any help. And I read the papers today. And I look at the approach to opioid use. And you hear about a health approach, not a criminal approach. I'm 21 years sober now. Wasn't I worth an investment in treatment?
That's the great Susan Burden, a friend, a mother figure to me, and mentor. She runs a new way of life in Los Angeles. And she started that home for women just coming back from a prison with her own money, her own investment, and it's now spread not just nationally, but internationally, leading Michelle Alexander to call her the Harriet Tubman of our time. And I want to kind of turn to her and to your brilliance too, Felecia, as somebody who studies addiction. We know that now that somewhere around 80 to 90% of the people who use any drug, from crack to heroin, to cigarettes, to alcohol, will never become addicted. They'll never develop addiction disorder. The data now tell us that it's co-occurring conditions that drive that. Carl Hart, who's featured prominently in the film and who's the world's leading neuroscientist on this, will instruct that addiction has little to do with the drug itself and far more to do with environmental, psychosocial, and personal factors people may have, for example, co-occurring psychiatric illness like depression or other factors, co-occurring pain, a wide range of other factors drive addiction. And so I'm interested in this and in what Susan will illuminate in the film, because she talks about her grief. She talks about her pain, what happened after she watched her son KK at 5 years old get run down by a police officer recklessly driving his car, that trauma never addressed. And so, you know, I'm kind of interested in looking at that with you, Felecia. Not the day that someone recovers, not the day that someone gets high, but actually what was it like before? And looking at some of those psychosocial, those environmental, those co-occurring realities, which I don't know that we give as much attention to, but I'd like to ask you to for us.
Thanks, Asha, and I really appreciate that question because I think the media does a great job of dehumanizing us as they portray the crack epidemic or any epidemic, the heroin epidemic of the 70s. And in that dehumanization, we stop looking at adverse child experiences. We stop looking at the root causes, the poverty, the depression, the anxiety. We live in environments that perpetuate chronic disease every day. The hypertension, the cardiac diseases and illnesses, the diabetes. And so when we are in constant stressful environments, we often need to turn to something and turn to escape from that environment. And you know, food, drugs, alcohol, gambling, sex, you know, other human beings are perfect escapes from those stressful environments. And so I think that it's really important as we begin to look at the individuals that are impacted by substance use disorders, we also look at some of those underlying conditions that they are really dealing with before ever picking up a drug. I think one of the most prolific scenes in the documentary is the young man, and you briefly touched on him earlier, the one who is just simply crying, "Don't take my mother." That is an adverse child experience. That is a trauma that has impacted him. And when left unchecked, when left undealt with, those traumas will always bubble up in some way, shape, or form. It may be in domestic violence. It may be in substance misuse. And so in I think that it's just really important that we look at the person as a whole to touch on some of that trauma, depression, anxiety, and before we can even begin to deal with putting down the drug itself.
Thank you so much for that framing. And this is, you know, Samson, where I want to ask you to continue helping us to unpack. I mean, just the bravery in which, you know, you shared your story in the film. Because I'm really interested in that 80 to 90% who do not develop addiction disorder, who also have stressors in their life, right? They also have adverse childhood experiences, but we don't lose them. And so I want to think about the co-occurring coincidence as well of entrenched poverty. And I don't think we actually look at what that really is and what that really means. And I wonder if Samson, because you talk about this, right? Starting, you know, trying to make money, trying to help your family. You're a baby. You know, you may have been in tenth grade, maybe 11th grade, and McDonald's pays, you know, $3.35 an hour, and minimum wage freezes that entire time under Reagan. And then here's a way to make money in support of your family. And I wonder what it was that you felt you had to do and what poverty actually looks like. And it was experienced emotionally, spiritually, in the bones.
You know, growing up in pink houses, despair and poverty is basically most that you see. I had a two-parent household and I didn't realize that was abnormal until I really looked at it and I said, hold up. Out of all the friends that I grew up with, and you're talking about pink houses have 22 buildings with at least maybe 64 families in each building. And I only
just to ground people, pink houses is here in East New York, Brooklyn, for those who are not here, and where a lot of murders also took place and was guided at that time by the legendary Johnny Ray Youngblood, the preacher out
there. Right. So pink houses have an infamous past. And out of the majority of people I grew up with, and I knew everyone, I was pretty popular. Like I said, 64 families, 22 buildings. And I could count, I can't even finish counting on one hand the amount of people I knew that had a mother and father in the household. But that's one thing. So we have a lack of, influence, positive influences. And it's like a bunch of babies raising each other, you know? And that causes us to make wrong decisions because we don't see the positive light. So when I tried, my mother, go get a job. Okay, I get a job at McDonald's. I'm making $3.35 an hour, which was the minimum wage at that time. You're making $3.35 an hour. You couldn't work over 20 hours because you had to work under the 40 hours because you're a child, right? So then the government's still taking half of that. They're not saying, hey, hold up, you don't have to pay no taxes, you're a kid, right? So they're still taking, you know, a third of that. So, you know, you barely just have enough for car fare back and forth and maybe lunch. Luckily, I'm working at McDonald's, I can eat at McDonald's for free, right? Other than that, you know, I may have a little $30, $40 to put up every week, and I have a baby on the way. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we idolize the people that we can see, what's attainable. And what's attainable is the guy on the corner making his money. We see that this is a quick way to success. You know, this is how we see success. And it's easily to be led in the wrong direction when you're in an environment that's like that. So, you know, they were, the media, like you said, got it wrong. And what this documentary does, it humanizes everyone, right? And that's what I love about it, because most of the time, the people that were in the game or hustling or users, they looked at as, you know, their throwaways. But these people had a past before this. They had an upbringing before they turned to this, right? Mm-hmm. And so this is like, you have, you know, you have a bunch of people that's in poverty and that's starving. And then here go, you drop off something in the middle. You drop off, you know, some food. Everybody's going to rush and fight each other for that food. That's just human nature. So I feel that all of this, it was strategically planned. They knew what would be the outcome. And once again, you know, the United States benefited off of our grief.
Thank you so much for that, Samson, and for just all the work you do. And Stanley, let me bring you back. I want to talk about, you know, what surprised you in the making of this film. You know, as you know, I've worked in drug policy specifically for many, many years. I know I was stunned to hear the actual rates of addiction disorder, stunned to learn that, you know, one hit doesn't addict anyone, right? That's a myth. The brain just actually doesn't work that way. Anytime someone tells you that, it's sort of a license to stop listening. And I wonder if there were things that you learned in this film that absolutely stunned you about, you know, turned over what you thought you knew.
Yeah, I mean, I think that so much of it was stunning to me. I mean, we start the film with Ronald Reagan accepting the nomination, you know, from the Republican Party. And he says, you know, I want to make America great again. Right. You know, it's like, whoa, you know, I can't believe it. You know, you know, so from there, you know, on that it was really a trajectory and it all connected. You know, we have a stunning scene where George Bush won, you know, holds up a huge bag of crack that, you know, he talks about being bought in front of the White House. And we go to the cop, you know, who busted the kid with the crack, and he talks about how it was all a setup. You know, he calls a kid and tells him to meet him at the White House so that he can bust him, so that Bush can hold up the crack. And the kid says, you know, where the hell's the White House? You don't even know where the White House is, you know, and they had it all set up to bust this kid, and they busted him, and he spent 10 years or so in jail. You know, it thing after thing, you know, it just rolls out the war on drugs and how that incarcerated so many people. Oh, I know what one of the things that's really stunning is that the African-American community, it got so bad, crack got so bad, that the African-American community, and we see this in the film, are holding marches to have more police in their neighborhood. Like, you know, that, which is like unbelievable. You couldn't imagine that today, right? But there's marches, you know, in Miami, in other cities, New York, other cities, to please bring more cops, just anything to stop this, because they let it get to be so bad.
Thank you for that. And Dr. Punter, I want to ask you to, you know, sort of something along those lines. I mean, I think about the way that most of us came up and the way that we thought about drugs having a value, you know, good or bad, worse, not worse. And you know, the science doesn't back any of that up. Conditions tell us a lot more. And I think about it, you know, what I thought in 2000, right around the time my own son was arrested, is my stepson, I co-parented him with his mother. Uh-huh. I was arrested and did 8 months for a week, you know, and we say that, you know, he went to, came home, he left prison, but he never came home. He would be killed in the end, you know, 15 years later, because he never got out of that cycle. And I wish that back then I would have known to tell him that, yes, he could live with me even if he smoked weed.
Right.
Yes, he could, right? And I had my own stigmas. And I wonder I didn't know about drug policy then. I only knew basically I was just a no generation person. And I wonder if there are things that you know now that you wish you'd known when you first became community involved.
You know, I think that the culture has led us all in the wrong direction in looking at the drug era, particularly the crack era. Many of the cultural elements that we've had in music, et cetera, has glorified that. Some of the men and women who were forced because of their economic impoverished condition to go to the street and illicit activities and drugs are glorified in our culture. But if you knew them, like perhaps Stanley did, and I certainly did because I lived there, they didn't want to be in that lifestyle. They were doing it to get out of that lifestyle if they were doing it at all. But most of them didn't survive. In the late 80s in Harlem, there was a really aggressive internal war with drug crews from one area and the other. There was so many so many bodies dropping into the street that, you know, many of those people who had potential, they were ingenious business thinking people, are no longer with us because they succumbed to either, you know, being murdered, extra long prison sentences, or they just didn't come back from their addiction. Mm-hmm. Because there's not everybody didn't survive. The people who survived are fortunate. I count myself amongst that fortunate lot. Because my friends that I grew up with, many of them are not here. And what happened in Harlem is that in New York City, when the militarization of the police department set in with aggressive policies such as the tactical narcotics team that you spoke about in the documentary that were based in the 369th Armory, that's the Buffalo Soldiers Armory in Harlem, and they were dragnetting and arresting people that didn't have drugs on them, as was depicted, I think, in one of the speakers in the film, that they would give you drugs even though you didn't have it. So that was the environment that, you know, we were living in. We were under siege in a military occupation because most of the people in the community just felt that it was a hopeless, you know, situation. And yes, they began to march. But they didn't really understand what they were marching about. They didn't march to say, you know, put our young men back in a virtual slavery, right? Because they, you know, used that loophole in the 13th Amendment of the Constitution. And we're talking about the ballooning of our prisons from, I think the statistic was 300,000 over 2 million and over 2 million to today. So that's countless souls are being incarcerated and their potential is being extinguished, which means that the children have no parents that no father figures to look after.
Yeah, thank you for that insight. I mean, I think that's, you know, something for us to think about, like, what did it mean that fathers were gone and then mothers, and what did that do? And so I guess I really want to rename this period. I just, too many white people used crack and cocaine, you know what I mean? And they don't fall apart. So I'm just going to keep saying that until we get it.
Right.
It wasn't the drug. We could call it the gun era, right? We can call it the gun era. Well, parents taken away, I think. And so you don't have that oversight. As you know, Samson can talk in more detail, children also didn't have to tip in to get into the game. Right. So that was just a big shift. You didn't have to have cash. You know, you got a grown man who's got his impulse control. They ain't not going to act like that. And but you don't have that in the 80s and 90s when crack was being sold. And you don't have fathers and you don't have uncles. You don't have folks who are already put in prison. And so, again, I want to look at this piece about what gets taken out of the communities along with regulation around weapons. You know, people used to actually fight with their fists, you know, worse than knife. Brooklyn was known for his knife game, not his gun game, right? And so I just, it's just constantly trying to shift our lens. And, you know, and Felecia, I do want to bring you back in and ask if there's lessons based on the wisdom in this film and the what we know now, and on all the data that's out here now that we can apply right now when it's, you know, constant talk about the overdose epidemic. Because I'll name too that, you know, cocaine has been here, you know, heroin has been here, opium has been here, and people weren't dying. And so what, you know, and so I wonder what the lessons are today, because it does seem like every generation there's this, you know, huge media report on this thing that's killing us, and then it goes away. Methamphetamine in the early 2000s, it's heroin right now. They get this data wrong on that. So can you help us think that through a little bit?
Sure. I think that there are really two lessons learned right now. One is, as we compare the crack epidemic to the current opioid epidemic, is that there are nanny and daddy state policies that are applied unequally across the races. We do know that a medical model is a better approach than incarceration all day long, but the justice model is typically applied to Blacks and Latinx, whereas the medical model is typically applied to white Americans. And so one that tells us as advocates and as policy advocates that we need to advocate for equal justice across the races, especially when it comes to substance use disorders. So for me, that's lesson one. I think that secondly, as we, you know, begin to look at distribution of, and Stanley talked about it briefly, and this, I sit on a task force for the city of New York on this opioid epidemic task force, and it's this top-down approach as we talk about policies of how can we help the people on the ground, but that never works. And so what I think is really important is that we begin to engage people on the ground, people in the communities, to become a part of the solution of that community. And so one example that, you know, we are looking at implementing now is hiring community members to be first responders in this opioid overdose problem that is very prolific in Harlem today. And so we can't stop talking about substance use disorders and the crack epidemic as an epidemic that was a part of Harlem. We need to continue to look at what's happening today, take a look at the policies that did not work yesterday and employ new ones now that include the community's voice in the community's solution to a community's problem.
Thank you so much for that. And Samson, I'm gonna ask you this question to sort of kick us off as we go into our final 8 minutes or so, and really then wanna bring everybody into it. And I wanna think about how we repair the harm. So many lives.
Similar to what Felecia just mentioned, is that people that were part of the problem have to start becoming part of the solution. It's similar to like the cure violence method when it comes to gun violence. You take people that's inactive, that was once active, and you bring them into the situation because they know what to look for. They know how to identify the causes and effects, and the people that are going through this can relate to them. You know, like I could go into a neighborhood and people know who I am and my background, and someone that another, you know, mature person may not be able to get the attention. And I could say, yo, come here, you know, let me talk to you, man. You know, I know what that's about. And they will agree with me because they know I've been through that. You're talking about prison, you know, you're talking about, you know, getting shot and all the harms that come with this, which you're getting ready to get yourself into. You would listen to me more so than you would someone that you feel that haven't been through that. And, you know, that's what's needed for us to start giving back to the communities and these people that was once part of the problem becoming part of the solution.
You know, that's always us. And then once again, I see your beautiful heart on display. I'm a little bit harder, Samson. And I'm like, what are we owed? I want to bring it right there because this film unpacks so much. Stanley, let me ask you to help us think through this question, right? Because it which is not to say in either or, but it is to say there were policies, there were decisions that were made, right? There were lies, not just to us, but to Congress. In the same way, those folks on Capitol Hill right now are trying to figure out how harm needs to be repaired because of the events of January 6th. What are we owed by a government that made decisions? And I'll say again, more drugs are used and sold in white communities. We did the time while they had the fun. And when they didn't have fun, they got the services, right? This is Susan Burton's query. Why didn't I deserve treatment? We talk about violence. You're talking about a nation that has instigated wars of aggression that go against its own international agreements. So the harm is real, and not just in our communities. The violence is real and doesn't sprout out, you know, just in our hands. It's not to take that away, but it's also to know, I think we're owed something. I'll just say that and let you take it.
Yeah, I mean, I think also that there's another way to look at, you know, what we're owed, right? We're owed something by the federal government, because we black communities all across the country got Trump out of there, right? White people, if you take black people out of the equation, Trump would still be president, right? So I'm really proud of black people, right? I'm really proud. You know, I'm proud of Georgia. When we heard there was a runoff in Georgia, you know, I don't know about y'all, but I was like, okay, that's it. You know, I ain't got no chance in Georgia. But, you know, black people turned out and got those guys elected, right? You know, black people got, and so we have to demand what's due to us because we got them in office. And I think sometimes, you know, when Obama got elected, it was like, okay, that's it. You know, Obama's elected. You know, Biden, okay, we got rid of Trump. That's it. No, we want our due now. We want something because we did that. We did that. And you know, and we have to own that. We did it. Okay. We want our due. And so I think that's one thing that you know, works in terms of politics and the political needs, because that's what they understand. You know, we got you elected. Okay, now we want something.
Thank you so much for that. You know, and I love it. It's always a great opportunity to bring in Stacey Abrams, who had an election stolen from her. And so it was specifically a black woman strategy that, you know, that won both of those seats, and they had to go to her and bow to her wisdom. As that architecture is built out. And let me say, you know, we've got, I think, 2 minutes here. And Dr. Punter, whose name I have screwed up this entire time, and I don't usually do that. Much more complex names I navigate my way through. Let me give the last word, because you're building homes. You're providing social services. So, brother, what are we owed for the harm that was caused?
Repair the harm. We're owed... and I, you know, first we owe an explanation why this federal government did not stop the supply. You know, cocaine doesn't grow in the United States. It doesn't grow in our country. It is grown in Central and South America. The first responsibility of the federal government is to protect the borders. We heard this in the past administration for reasons that were racist in nature, but we haven't heard why they didn't protect the borders from all of this infiltration of drugs, cocaine, heroin, and the like from countries as far as Afghanistan for heroin, and as close as Mexico.
Seconds.
So prepare to harm. We would like you to join us, HCCI, and purchasing as much real estate as possible. Take back your block by purchasing real estate. and then you can control the destiny of your community because you own your property, and then you can implement the social service programs that Felecia has and Brother Samson has that will help people strengthen themselves and get beyond their addictions or beyond their mental illnesses. Control the block.
Thank you so much. And streaming worldwide on Netflix is Crack, the incredible new documentary by Firelight Media. Let me thank you. Thank Image Nation. And I think that's it. I think that's all we have time for. Thank you all so much for joining us. And on behalf of everybody here today, thank you for listening and for joining the conversation. Be well, take care of each other, and love each other.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks.